And I want to consider in more practical terms some of the effects that globalization is having in the world and in terms of things that we can see. Now, basically, if you get any marketing company, they will tell you there are two kinds of approaches to international marketing. You can standardize your company image, and the classic case is Apple. For each promotional campaign, you will find the same images all over the world. And this would be the use of standardization as a strategy, where there is one internationalized version and there are places for translation. And translation is just about the only bit of localization going on. Okay, standardization, Apple, same product all over the world. All right, there you have it in two different languages. Can you tell which is which? Looking at the images, no, not at all. The other approach has various names, but adaptation is good enough for us. And remarkably enough, one of the companies that uses adaptation is Coca-Cola. This is Coca-Cola in the United States, and same day, Coca-Cola in China. I don't know how they claim to be ecologically beneficial for the world, but there you go. One image, one, another one. Different promotional campaigns for different companies. Same product, more or less, over the entire world. Okay, so standardization, as opposed to adaptation, are strategies determined by companies in relation to their marketing departments. But we can find adaptation happening in many places. This is one example. USA government. Okay, so you're going into the government of the United States and you're given options, and they think you'll be looking for a job. Aha, find a job over here, travel, money and credit, immigrate to the United States. All right, so those are things that people go in there looking for in English. Put it into Spanish, though, and that woman with a phone has become a man with railway tracks behind him. And guess what he's most interested in over here? Immigration and citizenship. Ha! Okay, and then money and credit and benefits, government benefits, and then travel. Okay, so the profile of the user changes. And not only does a translation change, but the website changes. The same content is there in the database, but it's being ordered in different ways on the splash page as you come in here to suit what they think you are looking for. And we are becoming very familiar with this kind of profiling of the user based on previous usage. But this would therefore be adaptation. Okay. You're invited to look around. The World Bank is a good one for seeing how the World Bank promotes itself differently in different languages, for example. What I like about the American one is it's got kids.gov, which is entirely different. And they've designed a whole new website for the kinds of things that kids have to do projects on at school. So don't forget about the kids. Now, this is my example. It's from, I think, 2 years ago. So I'm sorry it's not up to date, but you can go in to where you buy your furniture from, Ikea. And this is Ikea in China. And we can see it's got a rather limited space. They've got really good Chinese food on the table. It's for a family of a couple of people around there. There are some kids because there's toys up there, but the people are absent. Okay. And that's the image that you come in. What does this mean? It means make room for life, make room. So if you get some good furniture, you're going to have some good space around you. This is what it looks like in English in China. Okay, so make room for life. That's the slogan that they've translated. Brand new inspirations. That's good because there's not much room in a Chinese apartment, it seems. So it's a rather clever slogan. in Taipei for the same period. Interestingly enough, it's the same furniture. Do you recognize that furniture we just had? It was sort of standardization within China, which makes sense. You're just changing the language for the English speakers in China who are likely to buy this kind of furniture. Go to Taipei. It's the same people who've done the promotion. But hey, you know what? The people have come back. The people are remarkably Western looking, although there's a sort of different color going on in the background there. And they've got some musical instruments up here as well. They're all playing musical instruments. I don't know how well they're doing it because she's got an electric guitar and no amplifier, but let's pretend, all right? And here we're selling the catalog. So it's a different promotion using the same space, okay? In Hong Kong, same day, same slogan, make room for life. But we're just upfronting the catalog, okay? So we're reproducing that slogan, make room for life. Indonesia, same day. This is I love bad localization. This is not a good slogan, folks. Yeah. What do you want more room for in your life? All right, it makes sense, but if you read that in English, hey, what do you want more room for? You got plenty of room. You don't need more room. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make the same sense as the other localization. And you can see they've got the same catalog coming out. So it's an international promotion. And they've got an Indonesian type bag happening there as well. Okay. I think what happened is, I don't know why, but I think somebody translated the standard slogan for this campaign into Indonesian and then translated from the Indonesian back into the English, which really messed around with the slogan. Okay, so they're trying to say make more room. You know, good furniture. You feel you've got more room. Now, this is obviously just straight translation here. Okay, and that is localization. Yeah, because they're changing everything, even though they've got the same sort of slogan going there. Same day in the United Kingdom. What's happening? We've got a multiracial group of people, perhaps happy people sitting on chairs, jeans, young people. And for the first time, we have a price indicated here, which is intriguing. The other sites did not have a price. Perhaps price is not the reason people go to IKEA in those particular countries. Here in England, they do, in Britain. And it says uni essentials. So obviously this campaign came out in the period when students are going back to university, moving into houses and buying cheap furniture. So the campaign is very much pointed towards them. And that is obviously localization. You'll find the same menu appearing in all these. So this is standardization up here and standardization of the IKEA company symbol. Which is intriguing, by the way. Everybody says, if I ask you, why is that yellow and blue? You will tell me, because it's Swedish. And if you go into your local IKEA store, you'll find that their translation policy is to keep all the product names in Swedish. So it's like taking a trip to Sweden. I don't know why. In fact, if you look up the company, it is a design foundation registered in the Netherlands, and it doesn't have to pay tax because it promotes good design and it's artistic promotion. So, you know, go figure. International capitalism uses its symbols to pretend to be somewhere where it is not. Remember what I said about the original disappearing in internationalization? Yeah, well, there was a guy in Sweden who invented the idea of selling furniture that you put together at home and that you could fit into a car. Very good idea. That he disappeared, sold it to the big company. The company is registered in a different country, but keeps this iconic localization for its own image. And in the United States, same day again. price is important. You're going back to school in the United States, 20% off, and you've got the headers up here for the actual content. And I did look at Australia, lower prices. Price is important in some countries, not in others. Obviously, they're selling pretty flash sort of furniture for lower prices. And what I like is the reference to work. Australian culture notoriously prides itself on working hard, or used to at least. Same thing up here. So if you look at it closely, we're combining standardization for some parts of it with the writing of new content in others. And this new content is usually written by marketing people, except I suggest in the case of Indonesia, where it was a bad translator who got into the works. So what does that mean? The most global products can be symbolically localized and made to feel close to the user and the consumer. On most web pages, you can figure out very quickly which parts are for standardization with translation, straight translation involved, and which parts are for adaptation, often with more creative kinds of translation or simply the writing of a new campaign. If you look at those websites and that division of space, you will see very quickly, I think, that there's also a professional distinction between what translators will do in the classical traditional sense of the term, natural language replacement, and then localization, which increasingly goes to people in advertising and marketing. What's interesting is that the big money tends to go to the marketing people, the more creative people. And no matter how much we try to tell the world that translating is a creative process and it's not easy and we can change the way messages are received, our bit in the way this little world is divided, our bit is just there to a fairly straight language replacement. Perhaps we can tinker with the slogans a little, but the more creative stuff is happening on the marketing side, which is interesting. If you're looking for a future down the line, working with languages, yes, get trained as a translator. Yes, learn all the tricks that translators can play when they work with language, but you can also look at being employed within marketing, within promotion, in many, many aspects. Particularly since down the line, we think that neural machine translation may be able to take over a lot of the natural language replacement. And so the work of the translator will be post-editing. And that's post-editing, perhaps the least interesting or least dynamic part of the language in that product.